Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. I have an odd topic for you today, but one thing I feel is really starting to take over the internet, that is the rise of virtual influencers and maybe the possible death of the real influencer, including me. I want to talk about who virtual influencers are, why they're so popular, why brands love them, why the law hates them, and what I really think about them and where I think they're going in the future. And I'm going to be doing my evening skincare routine alongside that, starting with a product from today's sponsor, Saturday Skin. You know I love Saturday Skin. Well, now they have a new product. This is the new Saturday Skin Melt and Cleanse Makeup Melting Balm. And I have applied too much makeup. You can't really see it actually, in order to show you how it works. We all know what cleansing balms are, right? I love the double cleanse, and for me, cleansing balms are superior to oils. They are always my go-to for the first step of a double cleanse, or even the second, depends how you feel. This cleansing balm has a tri-phase texture, meaning obviously it goes on balmy, turns into a nice rich oil to help remove all that sunscreen and makeup. And then once you emulsify, which a lot of people forget this step, you emulsify and it turns into a really silky, creamy, milky lather. This is of course vegan and we have some really, really nice ingredients in here. It's almost like this sherbet-y kind of like whipped balm texture in the actual tub. Then it instantly starts melting. The moment you put it on your hand, it starts melting down. Ooh, careful. We have a ton of omega fatty acids in here, which come from the pumpkin and camellia seed oils to really help break down all that makeup. Look, you can see my rosacea and redness coming right through.
Oh, it smells so good. It's almost like
citrusy, but not like toilet fresh citrus. Probably the fruit acids we have in here, giving it this kind of like sweet citrus smell, but also contain really gentle AHAs, you know, nice fruit extracts to help gently exfoliate. So I like to take my time and massage very gently into the skin, especially areas where I have a bit of texture, a bit of pigmentation going on. They have something here called their Purple Complex, which is rich in superfoods and antioxidants. And actually that's a mix of purple cabbage, eggplant or aubergine as we call it here, beet and blueberries. And all this together is rich in antioxidants. It helps fight inflammation. Whilst the pumpkin and camellia seed oil really helps your skin barrier as well. The fruit mix is actually blueberries. So we've got lactic acid from the blueberries, citric acid from orange and lemons. Don't worry about lemons. You know, I have a thing about lemons, but when it's formulated into a product, it's perfectly safe to use and beneficial as well. And then we have a sugar maple fruit, which is malic acid. Kind of reminds you of PHA, where it's like gently exfoliating but also hydrating, and sugar cane, which is glycolic acid, but all very, very gentle. You see I'm just kind of massaging it and pushing it around the face a bit because I like to let this rest on my skin for a little while. So the next step is to add some warm water and emulsify, and as you can see it turns into this like foamy lather, emulsion-y milk. This is a step that usually people forget, and whilst it's not the most important step, I feel like if a brand tells you to emulsify their cleansing balm, you should. So I'm gonna go rinse this off right now and then come back. And I'm back with cleansed skin, not dry, not feeling tight. Final product I'm going to talk about from Saturday Skin is the Yuzu Vitamin C Sleeping Mask, which you'll see me use at the end of this routine as well as now. This is one of my favorite sleeping masks. And in fact, not just sleeping, it's like one of my favorite like daytime moisturizers. It's so deeply hydrating and nourishing. And I know this kind of phrase is overused, but it's like a drink for your skin. You feel that instant difference as far as the hydration levels of your skin, and you feel it as well. Yuzu is extremely high in vitamin C. It has 3 times the amount of vitamin C than any other citrus fruit, and they use the entire fruit. I say that every time I talk about this product, but they use the pith, you know, every single part of that fruit. And I've said this before, but I always felt like it gave me like a proper glow. You know when you see people doing glass skin and you think, oh, that's a really nice glow, and it doesn't really translate into real life. I feel like this gives me the glow it gives on camera. Do you know what I mean? Like I'll walk outside and I'll be glowy and dewy. We also have the 7-peptide mix, which is found throughout all of Saturday Skin's products. We know the benefits of peptides include barrier repair, possible anti-aging, keeping our skin looking plump, stretchy, elasticy, collagen-y. And use code 25JanesWelsh for 25% off Saturday Skin at the retailers listed in the description box down below. And whilst you watch me use this product, for reference to this video, I want you to look at my skin texture. I want you to see how the product's working and the changes to my skin, and bear that in mind for the video going forward. Thank you so much, Saturday Skin, for sponsoring this segment of today's video. Okay, I'm gonna go quite quickly in with the R&R Mineral Mist from Undefined Beauty. So first of all, let's start this video with what is a virtual influencer. I'm always surprised at the amount of people who haven't come across a virtual influencer, considering their staggering audience sizes. I mean, they're basically what they say on the tin. A virtual influencer is a CGI person, a CGI influencer, fake people who the majority of the time are almost made to look so real, you can't tell if they're real or not. But these CGI influencers, computer-generated influencers, CGI will do. They have their own careers, they have their own personalities, they have their own backstories, families, boyfriends. All these things that you would find from a real-life influencer, whatever it takes to make them come across as a real person. Behind each virtual influencer, you have a huge marketing team, however. Of course, you have the computer people, like the art directors, the people who actually physically make this virtual influencer, the art teams, you have the stylists, you have the actual marketing team and the managers who deal with the money, the sponsorships. Not every post is a sponsored post and they need to carry on this story. So you have people who will make up storyboards, you know, I don't know the exact layout of it, but there is a whole team behind this one influencer's life. Whereas with influencers like me, it's two or three people. And brands are starting to use them more and more. You may have seen one and not even known. In some cases, these virtual influencers are working along alongside already established influencers, even on red carpets with actors, in fat high-end fashion magazines with existing models. They are everywhere and they can advertise everything because they are a virtual influencer. Food, fashion, makeup, fitness, they are getting paid to advertise all this stuff. Now you may think, as I said, I've never seen one of these virtual influencers. Are they even that popular? Well, yeah, they really are. I'm gonna go in with another mist before I apply a serum I'm trying out. This is the Peach Slices Snail Rescue Intensive Serum with 95% snail mucin concentrate to reset and renew for clear and smooth skin. I've only just started using this, so no feedback as of yet, but I like it. It's almost like a gel moisturizer. Now, the vast majority of virtual influencers actually become very popular very quick, with most of them having hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of followers over on Instagram. You may have already heard me talking about this on my podcast with Robert, the Double Cleanse, but I'm going to go a bit deeper into it today. And so many brands actually launch their own virtual influencer that isn't even related to beauty, just to advertise their products and then eventually start working with other brands. KFC actually did it with their virtual colonel, who partnered with brands like Dr. Pepper, Old Spice, and the car brand Renault actually created their own called Live, who didn't look very good. It looked like it was done on a bit of a budget. But some of those popular ones, I'm sure you would recognize. The probably the most popular, she says that she's the original, but I believe Barbie was the original online virtual influencer. She had like a YouTube channel and everything, but Lil McQuayla, with 3 million followers, is probably the original virtual influencer as we know it today. She was actually created by tech startup Brood, whose co-founder is Trevor McFedries, I think you pronounce it, and he was actually a really famous DJ and producer. His work with people like Kesha, Chris Brown, Katy Perry, and you know, this virtual influencer, Lil McQuayla, has done loads. She has worked with some of the biggest brands and biggest celebrities that we know. She's worked with Samsung, Calvin Klein, and unsurprisingly, with her creators linked to the music industry, she's actually a singer as well. She has a couple of songs. We also have Shudu, who is on 233,000 as of when I wrote this script. She became super popular after being reposted by Fenty. She is so photorealistic. It's craziness. Like, you see every bit of texture, pore, like, she looks real. I, for the longest time, thought she was an actual model. She is now an official Balmain ambassador. We have Rosie, a South Korean virtual influencer with over 100,000 followers. She became really popular after first being seen in an advert for Shinan Life. And I was flicking through her Instagram, and because of the translation issues, I couldn't quite see how much advertising she did, but it does look like a fair few pictures were ads for things like vitamins, supplements, shoes, clothing, you know, things that influencers advertise. And then there's someone called Bermuda, and I don't know if this is real or not, because I think she was a pro-Trump influencer who hacked into Lil Miquela's Instagram and they had beef, but now they're friends. I don't know. I'm not into fake people's drama, let alone real people's drama. You know, I don't really care, but that's an odd one too. In fact, there is actually a whole kind of modeling agency for these virtual influencers. It's called The Digitals, with only 7 models so far. And that includes Shudu, a model called Dagny, Bren, Coffee, Jay Young, Boyce, and actually an alien model called Galaxia as well. Honestly, looking at it, if this was a modeling agency, you think small, but really nicely diverse. But that is something I want to come back to. So what brands actually work with these virtual influencers? Because they've got some followers. Quick respritz. I'm feeling quite dry. I'm feeling quite parched. So I'm going to go in with the Pat McGrath Labs Divine Skin Rose 001, the Essence. I've used this a lot. This is my second bottle. I've used it way more than I thought I was going to. But for dry, dehydrated skin, it's like Laneige Cream Skin Refiner, but so much better. I definitely overused it last time. You only need a tiny amount. So mainly fashion brands use these digital virtual influencers. And magazines, you know, we see them in Vogue a lot, Elle. But we have brands like Way, Coca-Cola, Mercedes, Essence Cosmetics, Dermalogica, and at the time, KKW Beauty. Dermalogica's one is very, very different because she was actually made for education purposes. Tyush's called it is actually used to educate Dermalogica star. She was made to realistically and accurately depict the skin's aging and help Dermalogica staff better understand skin conditions, you know, things like that. You can see Natalia's skin in great, great detail and accuracy. It's, you know, it's interesting that they're being used in this way. As with everything, it has its pros and cons. And for me, the cons vastly outweigh the pros. I mean, let's talk about the pros first of all. So it does sound like these virtual influencers have a lot going for them. First of all, they're cheaper. They're cheaper to hire than an actual living person because more work and labor, I guess you can say, physical labor goes into creating content as a human. With less time, you usually have to be put into the actual campaign. There's no setup, there's no real script other than what the brand tells the virtual influencer to say. You know, there's a lot more time when one person is having to do it alone versus a team who can all work on different campaigns all at once. That also means the virtual influencer is easier to brief. I can speak for myself and probably other influencers that there is sometimes a fair amount of back and forth when it comes to what you do want to say and what you don't want to say when it comes to a sponsorship. You know, little things that you work out with a brand to make it more natural and what you actually want to represent. This also means there's less editing. Usually for a full video sponsorship or piece of Instagram content, there's usually 1 to 2 different edits before you see the final edited piece of content. However, with virtual influencers, instant changes can be made because, you know, you have a whole team, as I said, working on many different campaigns. You know, if I had to change something, I might be gone off somewhere for a week or I have other jobs to do, so the brand will have to wait a few days, blah, blah, blah. You don't get this with a virtual influencer. And that campaign is gonna come out perfect because everything is fake. The street, the time of day, the sunlight, how their skin looks, you know, how the product looks. Ultimately, it saves time and money for the brand. But there are other benefits. Drama and scandal, dark past, dark histories are a huge part of the downfall of not just influencers, but also the brands that the influencer associates with. These are influencers that don't have any particular political views in most cases. There's so much brands can escape from that really, with real life influencers, they would have to take some responsibility in being vocal about and being held accountable for. Also, virtual influencers don't age, they don't get sick, they're just available all the time. These brands get access to models of all skin colors, tones, nationalities, races, genders. In some cases, they're racially ambiguous, like we saw from Dermalogica. And whilst I do think it's nice to see all these racially ambiguous models and influencers garner as much attention as some of these virtual influencers are, that's also part of the issue for me. Let's talk about the cons. The one thing that really kind of bothers me, irks me quite a bit about these virtual influencers and sticks out the most is this almost fake inclusivity. I don't think the answer to creating inclusivity, especially for race as we see from these models, is just using a darker skinned virtual influencer. There are plenty of real life black models and models of color who need work and representation and could work just as hard as a lot of these virtual influencers. Another issue for me is also the diversity stops at skin color. That's it. There's no variation of body sizes, skin textures, abilities. In fact, aliens are better represented than a lot of other groups. I think they served a really good purpose during lockdown and COVID, and that's kind of when they became really popular because brands were starting to use these virtual influencers to advertise their new products because influencers can do it. We can go out anywhere. And I feel like a lot of people got interested in it because we were like, at that time, the world was so confusing. We didn't know what was next. You know, we all thought maybe virtual influencers are what's next. Maybe that's the next big thing. You know, the future is crazy, all that kind of stuff. I said on the podcast when we talked about this that Luna Beauty, who is Manny Emmyway's makeup brand, did a shoot using two virtual influencers. I didn't even realize because the campaign was shot during COVID, yet as a brand, they still want to be inclusive and use models of different skin colors. And I think that's a really good example of when virtual influencers are used in a really good way and in a way that makes sense. You know, these aren't personalities offline. They're one of virtual influencers that we use for a really good reason. And we'll talk a bit more about the race issue in a minute when we talk about the controversies that some of these influencers have actually come up with. They're not all drama free. Another con is there is a huge issue when it comes to the reliability and accuracy of these product reviews from virtual influencers. From people who don't exist. These brands, instead of showing how makeup, hair, skincare really works on real people with real skin texture, like you saw me using these products at the beginning of the video, they're creating fake results on fake skin that, whilst yes, it may have some pores, is technically perfect. These brands get their products made into CGI and then they get to show exactly how their product works in the exact way they want it to appear that it works. So speaking of real skin and real texture, I'm gonna use the Sete Skin Yuzu Vitamin C Sleep Mask. Again, this is just like an instant dose of hydration for me. Daytime, nighttime, it's just perfect. I wake up still with dewy skin, yet it's light enough to use during the day. You know, whilst I'm using this, you can see the stages that my skin goes through whilst I'm using the product. A realistic application process. You know, I know there's a real deep mistrust for influencers and product reviews, especially sponsored product reviews, but at least you're seeing the product really working and what its results are actually doing and what results are actually achievable. Brands and influencers rightly get called out for doing CGI swatches or pretending to use products, but no one seems to care when a fake person is using fake makeup and showing off their fake results in a perfectly curated advert. It just doesn't make sense why this is beneficial in any other way other than to save the brand money. I know some of you are already thinking it, but there must be some legal issues here. I had a little look around. One of my favorite websites is truthinadvertising.org, tina.org, and they have a whole section on virtual influencers and kind of the issues surrounding them. They say the term virtual influencer does not appear in the FTC's endorsement guides, which the agency uses to tackle deceptive influencer marketing, ranging from undisclosed adverts to the promotion of products the influencer doesn't actually use, amongst other things. And that's what it is. It's deceptive marketing because it's weird. But I honestly don't think people are looking at these people as influencers. I just think they get a big following and click-throughs because it's interesting to look at, and I get that. I'll talk about more about that in my conclusion. Tina.org goes on to say that, in fact, between 2019 and 2020 alone, Tina.org investigated the use of virtual influencers in social media marketing and catalogued a fair few deceptive marketing posts from 28 virtual influencers ranging from the human-like to overly cartoonish. There were more than 80 brands totaling 250 sponsored posts, as well as more than 50 lifestyle posts designed to portray the virtual influencer as human. Now, not all of these were undisclosed adverts. That's kind of not the point. The issue is the false claims, the fact that a person who isn't real is pretending that they use the product and love the results. Let's talk about some of the controversies. Yes, virtual influencers have their own drama. Despite what I said about this being kind of like a pro when it comes to virtual influencers, so they don't come with drama, there are still real people behind these influencers and marketing people making some very, very, quite honestly disturbing choices. Last year, for example, Calvin Klein had to apologize for queer baiting after a 30-second online advert showed Lil Miquela kissing supermodel Bella Hadid. The issue here is that both identify as heterosexual. I briefly mentioned Lil Miquela, but she is probably the most influencer-y virtual influencer of the bunch. She has a YouTube channel where she kind of like does these vlogs. She does like sit down kind of think pieces. She posts content you expect to see from a 19-year-old and talks about everything from K-pop to the Free Britney movement to a very, very public breakup with who I presume is a TikToker, because all kids are nowadays, but she shares her political views as well. However, the online community rightfully said that her creators went too far when in 2019, when they posted a video of her discussing her being the victim of a sexual assault in a rideshare through the app Lyft. She went through this whole story, talking about how the car smelled, what the rider looked like, what he was saying. Essentially saying that this rider who knew who she was, he was touching her inappropriately, and basically wanted to know how real she really was. This was told, in my opinion, when you watch the vlog back, in this kind of like oddly comical way. Not that it was funny, but it was like the team were trying to make this very serious situation into some kind of quirky story time video for YouTube. It's bizarre. When you watch it, there's like memes popping up, there's odd zooms in and out and sound effects. It's such a bizarre and confusing decision. This rightfully outraged so many people, with many tweeting that you can't play with real life people's traumas and these very real stories and situations. But for a marketing company to use a story like this just to make their virtual influencers seem realistic is actually really disgusting and horrific. It's ridiculous. Meanwhile, Shudu, who claims she was the first digital supermodel, has often been referred to as a white man's digital projection of real-life black womanhood. That's because she's created by white fashion photographer Cameron James Wilson, who is a self-taught 3D artist and creator of the Digital's modeling agency we were discussing earlier. I mentioned that it's great to see this kind of diversity on, you know, the first page of a modeling website, but what we didn't know back then is that the man financially benefiting from these models of color, black models, and an alien was a white man. Cameron James Wilson says that Shudu represents what I've always seen as beautiful, but something I don't often see enough. Although there's a slight change happening now, more people need to question what really is beautiful. So he is basically saying that, you know, I did this because there's not enough black women like this represented in fashion. He goes on to say that he never had any ill intentions and is not planning on using Shudu as a commercial model. To me, she's special, yes, but as are millions of real life African men and women. However, many black women in particular on Twitter saw this as exploitation of black women, with one tweet kind of really summing up everyone's thoughts on this. They say a white photographer figured out a way to profit off black women without ever having to pay one. Now please tell me how our economic system is no way built on, and quite frankly reliant on, racism, misogyny, and blaxploitation. And I pretty much agree with all of this. Yes, Shudu is a stunning, stunning black model who is hyper realistic, but I personally don't think the answer to getting more representation of black models in magazines, Asian men, etc., is to create a picture-perfect 3D render of one and hire them out for brands to use, which I'm pretty sure they're doing. When we take a closer look at the Digital's website, there is a section called Muse, where James Wilson shares the faces and voices behind a lot of the models. We have voice actors, model references, body references, and stand-ins for Shudu, all black women, and by the looks of it, they're all getting paid to be part of his marketing. However, I still stand by the fact that I don't think this is the answer to better representation. Another controversy, and which is the main thing, is that these virtual influencers do not have opinions, beliefs, or real life experiences and cannot generally be genuine users of these products. And I think this should be addressed. Like, this is a huge controversy. These people are putting out fake adverts. It's just not fine. What's my final takeaway then? I'd be lying if I said I wasn't interested in virtual influencers. I think they're really fun to look at, but kind of like a cartoon that's come off the TV and now is living on social media in like this fantasy, cool artwork kind of way. But what bothers me really is that none of the laws, the expectations, the ethics that are kind of like expected from real life human influencers transfer into virtual influencers. There's a lack of diversity, there's a lack of ethics. No one expects these virtual influencers to speak out on current issues. And there is a real lack, not that I think anyone has to, but you will find influencers get prodded to speak out on everything that's going on. A real lack of understanding when it comes to the laws of being an influencer and brand advertising. This very much reminds me of the early days when all the adverts on TV was a supermodel who had been paid to be there to say exactly what the brand wanted them to say, all in this perfectly curated advert. It reminds me of those early days and the reason why influencers became popular in the first place. Influencers became popular because of, at the time, their authenticity, their real life situations, the real hair, the real skin, the real bodies, the real lives in general. This made viewers feel like they were getting genuine feedback on products, how products really work, how clothes really fit. at people's everyday diets, you know, everything, all real life. And maybe the influencer and advertising industry has become so mainstream, with companies spending billions every year on influencer marketing, that we swayed away from the reason why influencers became so popular in the first place. So much so that people seem to trust the robot now, more than ever. And these big brands and businesses can hide behind their influencer, because their virtual influencer, because Their whole spiel is usually that they're meant to be a real person, so you're not supposed to know who's behind creating these virtual influencers. I personally don't believe virtual influencers should be advertising anything that can change your appearance, the way your skin looks, healthy bodies. But I think we really have to be careful with what is being advertised, what is legally allowed. I personally do not think that people think virtual influencers are the future. I don't think they're gonna be, because the bigger it gets, as they're as popular as they are, it's still pretty underground. They're not mainstream. But the bigger they get, the bigger people are gonna see what's going on. They're gonna be like, hang on, why are you advertising like moisturizer on fake skin? They're a bit of fun, I feel, and I really don't think people see them as any more than that. Let me know what you think in the comments down below, and thank you once again to Saturday Skin for sponsoring today's video. And don't forget to use my discount code 25JamesWelsh for 25% off Saturday Skin products at selected retailers listed down below. You can watch some more product reviews here and some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.